Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Blue Revolution: Hunting, Harvesting, and Farming Seafood in the Information Age, by Nicholas Sullivan, narrated by Bob Johnson. Preface: The Blue Revolution, version 2.0. This book is about the transformation of commercial fishing from maximizing volume to maximizing value, from wild hunting to controlled harvesting and farming. It's about sensible stakeholders staring at a tragedy of the commons that has depleted a global natural resource and collaborating to preserve the resource and its ocean habitat. Commercial fishing, long a traditional throwback industry, is moving in fits and starts into the post-industrial age, propelled by the fourth industrial revolution of big data, sensors, machine learning, and artificial intelligence. The fish in our stores and on our plates are increasingly the product of smart decisions about ecosystems, environment, waste, efficiency, transparency, and quality. The Blue Revolution of the 1980s, which followed the agricultural Green Revolution that started in the 1960s, was largely an Asian phenomenon that focused on doubling production of farmed freshwater fish, such as carp and tilapia. Over the last two decades, the Blue Revolution has spread around the world and moved into a new phase, increasingly focused on marine species and increasingly dependent on digital tools and new technologies for both wild capture and farmed seafood. This transformation of seafood production represents a dramatic pullback from the relentless industrial hunting of fish that started after World War II and peaked in the 1990s, and the industrial farming of fish that began in earnest in the 1990s. This book's subject matter is global, but the framing lens is New England, where American commercial fishing started in the pre-colonial era as arguably the country's first industry. For centuries, the legendary hunting grounds of Georgia's Bank and the Gulf of Maine, the nutrient-rich waters fueled by the interaction between the cold, south-flowing Labrador Current and the warm, north-flowing Gulf Stream, have made commercial fishing an integral part of New England's socioeconomic fabric. In terms of seafood value, Maine ranks second in the nation, largely thanks to lobsters, and Massachusetts third, largely thanks to scallops. Alaska is first, thanks to wild salmon and pollock. New England is also home to the top value, New Bedford, and oldest, Gloucester, American ports, the oldest fish pier, Boston, and numerous world-class ocean research institutes and universities that are collaborating with fishermen and fish farmers to modernize the industry. New England is a good case study for the rise, fall, and rebirth of an ancient industry. Focusing on a historic fishing region that is driving or adopting new models shines a light on ways to maintain healthy and sustainable wild capture and mariculture, marine aquaculture, industries. That has relevance for every other fishing nation and region. And, as the world's top importer of fish, the United States has leverage to change the way the world's top traded food is produced and distributed. I have been following this industry since I was in college in the 1970s, when I watched and wrote about Russian factory ships from the shores of Cape Cod. I was taken by the fact that fishermen in Chatham on Cape Cod had formed a cooperative to combat the Russian incursion, while fishermen in New Bedford kept to their individualistic free market ways. That foreign plunder of the hallowed Georgia's Bank fishing grounds, first fished by the Basques in A.D. 1000, led to the introduction of the 200-mile territorial limit in 1976. Since the 1980s, I have lived near New Bedford. I have watched as government subsidies in the 1980s enabled American fishermen to buy bigger boats and ravage the fish stock as the Russians had been doing a decade before, which led to the slow but steady collapse of cod stocks in the Northwest Atlantic Ocean. I saw the shutdown of the Atlantic sea scallop industry in the 1990s and its rebirth in 2000, thanks to collaboration between fishermen, scientists, and regulators. Scallopers morphed from hunters into harvesters, rotating beds like land farmers to protect the resource. As a result, scalloping has blossomed into a nearly $600 million fishery. Thanks to strong U.S. fishery management, there are now more groundfish, bottom-feeding fish, in the greater Atlantic region, ranging from Cape Hatteras to the maritime boundary between the United States and Canada, than there were 20 or 30 years ago. After a 50-year oscillating wave of crisis and response, this recent fishing rebound seems different. The demise of the Atlantic cod, in part a function of an unanticipated acceleration of warming in the Gulf of Maine, was a real wake-up call for scientists, regulators, and fishermen. Now, with sensors, underwater cameras, robotics, satellite imagery, and advanced data analytic tools, all stakeholders are refining their view of the marine ecosystem. The Global Fishing Watch website, for example, allows a near real-time view and location of most large fishing boats on the oceans at any time, a breakthrough in transparency. In the late 1970s, I wrote a proposal for a book called Fish Tales, which was more about fishermen than fish as food. I saw fishermen as 19th-century Americans, rugged individualists who were anti-union and anti-government, and who didn't take subsidies like dirt and dairy farmers did. They lived in another world. They were cowboys of the sea. I never finished that book. I went into the magazine world, writing and editing stories about business, technology, and eventually development economics. And that, some 40 years later, brought me back to fishing. Food security is, of course, a pillar of development economics, and in many parts of the world, fish is the main source of protein. More than 3 billion people now get 20% of their protein from fish, second only to milk as a protein source. That number is 26% in developing countries, according to the United Nations Food and Agricultural Organization. Fish is lean protein that also provides essential vitamins and minerals and omega-3 fatty acids. As the world population edges toward 10 billion and more people eat more fish, demand for fish will continue to increase. Between 1990 and 2018, global fish consumption rose by 122%. Given the stress on wild fish stocks in the ocean, where are the fish going to come from? The short answer is from farmed fish, which already account for more than half the fish eaten globally. But wild fish, at roughly half of today's production, are still a big part of the answer, especially as wild hunting morphs into sustainable harvesting. That's happening in the United States and a significant swath of the rest of the world. As for farmed fish, there are clear ecological and environmental benefits compared to meat production, what I call Fish for a Small Planet, after the best-selling Diet for a Small Planet, Francis Moore LePay, in the 1970s. Fish production uses less space. A water farm is a three-dimensional farm. Almost no land or water. Ocean water suffices, and land-based fish farms recirculate most of the water they use. And fish have a far superior food conversion ratio compared to land animals, given the physiology of fish and their ability to efficiently convert feed into energy and protein. Most reporting about commercial fishing laments the decline of wild fish due to overfishing and the negative side effects of fish farming. That reflects and contributes to the largely negative public perception of both wild and farmed fish, a perception seemingly fixed 20 or more years ago when environmental non-governmental organizations filed numerous lawsuits against the fishing industry and its regulators to bring an end to overfishing and protect against accidental bycatch. There is no denying the ongoing major problems afflicting global fisheries: illegal, unreported, unregulated fishing, degradation of mangrove swamps and the seafloor, and use of drift nets, outlawed by the United Nations in 1992, that collect everything from seabirds to turtles to sharks to tunas and octopi. And there is too much waste. Nearly 60% of most landed fish goes unused or is converted to low-value pet food and fertilizer. Those are the issues that attract public attention, as they should. What is less often reported and thus less well known is the 21st century transformation of the country's original industry. Transformation from unsustainable to sustainable, from sustainable to restorative, from industrial to post-industrial. A growing fishy movement parallels the decades-old locavore foodie movement. New entrepreneurs and inventors are developing ways to create more value from fish beyond the food product, which helps lessen fishing pressure and provides new business opportunities in coastal communities. Global fisheries aren't done yet. They are slowly joining the fourth industrial revolution, giving more than a ray of hope for the last commercially hunted wild food. Illegal fishing, climate change, and conservation are certainly major worries. But the good news is that mariculture has significantly reduced its negative side effects as it has scaled. On the wild side, marine extinctions are negligible to date, and fish stocks have shown that they will rebound quickly if protected. That is the story I want to tell, and I do so by telling the stories of people who are changing this ancient industry. Notes on the book. Structure. The book is split more or less evenly between wild capture fisheries and mariculture, with a shorter concluding section on the global challenges of illegal fishing, conservation, and climate change. Endnotes. I use endnotes to source third-party material from newspapers, magazines, books, and websites. The exception is quotes from people, more than 100, I interviewed. If there is no endnote, the quote is from a direct interview with me. The term fisherman. I generally default to the Slow Fish USA, an outgrowth of the International Slow Food Organization approach. In the U.S. context, fisherman is an inclusive and gender-neutral term for us, and the one used most commonly among women in our network who fish. It's meant to refer to those who might also use the terms fish harvesters, fisherwomen, fisher misses, fishers, and intertidal gatherers, as well as those practicing restorative aquaculture on a sustainable scale. I have mostly followed this practice, as most wild capture fishermen are male. That is less true in mariculture, which is attracting women scientists and entrepreneurs, and artisanal fisheries are dominated by women. So I sometimes use the gender-neutral term, fishers. The art. Each chapter opens with a fish print created by Stephanie Mason. A graduate of the Rhode Island School of Design, Mason was a textile designer in New York and Boston before she moved to Gloucester, Massachusetts, and became intrigued by the 19th century Japanese folk art of gyutaku, the painting and rubbing of fish to preserve a record of the size of the species. Each print includes a Japanese hanko, or chop, as a signature. The process starts by painting a dead fish, placing paper directly onto it, then gently rubbing to produce a unique and beautiful art form, says Mason. Throughout this journey, I have documented many species that are now under strict fishing regulations. Most of the fish she paints are caught off the coast of New England. Part 1. Wild Capture Fisheries. When people hear about overfishing, they may think fish are disappearing. Some stocks are certainly in distress, but overfishing is not the only reason. Fish go through sometimes inexplicable spawning cycles, and climate change is changing habitats. In countries with strong regulatory regimes, like the United States, fish are generally sustainably harvested, meaning stocks will continue to yield if fishermen stick to their catch quotas. Globally, the proportion of fish stocks that are within biologically sustainable levels was roughly 66% in 2017. In terms of landings, a more important metric, roughly 79% of marine fish landings were from biologically sustainable stocks, according to the Food and Agricultural Organization of the United Nations. Of course, these numbers usually don't include the huge artisanal small boat catch in many parts of the world. Seafood is the world's top-traded food commodity, and the United States is the largest importer in the world. The quip is that Boston's Logan Airport is the top fishing port in the country because Americans export most of what they catch and import most of what they eat. But an emerging local catch and community-supported fishery movement may be breaking that global supply chain and introducing consumers to hitherto underutilized but plentiful species. In addition, more fishermen are selling both fresh and flash-frozen fish direct to consumers, and entrepreneurs and innovation clusters are devising new ways to hunt and farm more efficiently and to get more value from landed fish, which increases profits for fishermen and lessens fishing pressure. Chapter 1. Sacred Cod, Sustainable Scallops. It is the same old story. The buffalo is gone. The whale is disappearing. The seal fishery is threatened with destruction. Fish need protection. Edwin W. Gould, Maine's Fishery Commissioner, 1892. I am a pirate, Carlos Rafael once told a group of federal regulators at a New England Fisheries Management Council meeting. It's your job to catch me. And they did. Rafael, a.k.a. the Cod Father, for his ruthless command of the docks, was one of the most successful fishermen on the East Coast. Originally from the island of Flores in the Azores, Rafael owned more than 40 boats, both scallopers and ground fishing trawlers, in New Bedford, the top value fishing port in the United States for the last 20 years. Most boats were painted green and emblazoned with his trademark CR. Many had Greek names like Poseidon, Hercules, and Hera. Some had Portuguese names like Açores and Ilha do Corvo, an Azorean island. In 2015, he employed 285 fishermen and paid them salaries of $12 million. He paid out another $4 million to local businesses for repairs, equipment, and supplies. Rafael was said to control 25% of ground fishing on the East Coast. Writer Ben Goldfarb described Rafael in Mother Jones as a stocky mogul with drooping jowls, a smooth pate, and a backstory scripted by Horatio Alger and Machiavelli. Rafael called his smaller competitors mosquitoes on the balls of elephants. Rafael is not necessarily representative of today's fishermen, but he was the epitome and one of the last vestiges of an old-fashioned cutthroat hunter from the good old days in an industry now being modernized by regulatory checks and balances to protect habitat and fish stocks. In 2016, after an undercover sting, he was arrested and eventually indicted on charges of conspiracy, tax evasion, bulk cash smuggling, and submitting falsified records to the federal government to evade federal fishing quotas. In addition to his boats, the Cod Father owned distributors on the docks. When he caught fish subject to strict catch limits, like cod or yellowtail flounder, he would report it as haddock or some other plentiful species. He mislabeled an estimated 782,000 pounds of fish over a four-year period, 2012 through 2015. Rafael got away with it for years because he laundered the illegal fish through his own wholesalers in New Bedford and fish dealers in New York City. We call them something else. It's simple. We've been doing it for over 30 years, Rafael told two Russian-speaking undercover IRS agents who feigned interest in buying his business. Rafael was asking $175 million, even though his book showed $21 million in assets. This year, I'll have 15 million pounds of haddock, so I can sell any son-of-a-bitch haddock if the bastards are not there. I rename them. Even when they're there, I disappear them. I could never catch 15 million pounds. It's impossible. Raphael described a deal he had going with a New York fish buyer at South Street Seafoods, a convicted felon who bought mislabeled fish in exchange for bags of cash, what Raphael called jingles. "You'll never find a better laundromat," Raphael told the New York Times. Raphael told the IRS agents he had received $668,000 in cash from New York for his mislabeled fish. It later turned out he had worked with a local Bristol County deputy sheriff to smuggle bags of cash to his native Portugal without clearing customs. "You could be the IRS in here. This could be a clusterfuck. So I'm trusting you. The only thing is, I open myself because both of you is Russians, and I don't think they would have two Russians. Fuck me, that would be some bad luck." Caught on tape, the jig was up. The undercover agents were part of a joint investigation by the IRS and the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, NOAA. In 2018, Raphael, 65, pled guilty to conspiracy, false labeling of fish, bulk cash smuggling, tax evasion, and falsifying federal records. He was fined $3 million, enjoined from fishing ever again, and sentenced to 4 years in jail, and the feds impounded 14 of his groundfish boats for more than a year to compensate for his past sins of overfishing. That left just 7 groundfishing boats active in New Bedford, and cost its company $500,000 a day in lost revenues and 300 jobs in the supply chain as landings dropped by 25%. In a port that has seen ups and downs since the whaling era of the 19th century, this was a new low. The story of the Codfather, a modern-day self-professed pirate, is an allegory for the anti-science wild capture fish industry. In New Bedford, where the fishing industry was built on its bountiful cod, yellowtail flounder, and scallop catch from Georgia's Bank and the Gulf of Maine, a cutthroat hunter illegally caught cod, lied about it, and did time while inflicting serious harm on the whole fleet and local suppliers. Many in New Bedford, fishermen, politicians, media, and the general public, conflated the demise of the Codfather with the demise of the cod itself, a signal that the groundfish fleet had hit rock bottom. And it wasn't just cod. Yellowtail flounder was also in distress, and New Bedford had once been known as a flounder port. Groundfish ports all over New England, Portland, Maine, Portsmouth, New Hampshire, Gloucester, Massachusetts, Point Judith, Rhode Island, were taking a hit. The number of ground fishing vessels in New England dropped from roughly 350 in 2000 to double digits in 2020. Meanwhile, the cod have more or less disappeared, maybe into canyons in the Gulf of Maine, maybe to the Barents Sea and the Arctic Ocean, where cod stock seems stable. Or maybe they have just disappeared after the intense overfishing of the late 20th century. In the 1980s and early 1990s, fishermen annually landed over 60,000 metric tons of Georgia's Bank cod and 20,000 metric tons of Gulf of Maine cod. In 2018, fishermen caught a mere 887 metric tons of Georgia's Bank cod and only 504 metric tons of Gulf of Maine cod. In fact, cod have been disappearing since the Civil War. Historical records indicate that massive populations of this predominantly bottom-feeding, hence groundfish species, were targeted by Basque fishermen around AD 1000 and kept secret for 500 years. In 1850, the total biomass of Atlantic cod was approximately 10.2 billion tons, according to in-depth research by the Sea Around Us project at the University of British Columbia, headed by eminent fisheries biologist Daniel Pauly. Information regarding the size of the Atlantic cod population circa 1850 was gathered from an analysis of mid-19th century logbooks maintained by a hand-lined fleet that fished the Scotian Shelf off the coast of Labrador, the center of the range of northwestern Atlantic cod prior to the industrialization of fishing. By 2005, Pauly and postdoc researcher Ashley McCree Strub estimated that this biomass had been reduced to roughly 3.5% of its initial size in 1850. deep-water trawlers, which became prevalent after World War II, pierced one of the cod's protective mechanisms, depth. Depth was once a vault for the cod, when fishing gear only went down 150 feet or so, says Pauly. The cod could duck under that, but not now. Massachusetts and the Atlantic cod go way back. Pacific cod is a different species. So the recent disappearance is a blow to the solar plexus for New England fishermen as well as New England at large. In 1642, Gloucester, Massachusetts was given a charter to profit from the fishing of cod, a fish that can live 20 years, grow to more than 4 feet long, and weigh as much as 50 pounds. The sculptor and architect, Maya Lin, who created an artistic timeline of cod, said, "We don't realize that a cod was bigger than a man in 1895. In Boston, a painted carving of a sacred cod has hung in the State House since 1784, when it was said you could walk across Boston Harbor on the backs of cod. Cape Cod got its name from the fish. Canada and the cod go back even farther, 500 years. In Canada, inshore small boat fishermen noticed the cod beginning to disappear from their net traps in the mid-1980s, but the loss was initially masked by huge offshore catches taken by deep-water trawlers. It turns out that scientists assessing the stock had focused on those trawlers and ignored the nearshore fishermen. In 1992, the Canadian government placed a moratorium on cod fishing, immediately putting 19,000 fishermen in Newfoundland out of work, and another 20,000 jobs were lost or severely diminished. Today, Canadian quotas are minimal, although the stock is now rebuilt to 25% of its 1980s level. Overfishing is certainly the primary cause of the decline, but there are other possible explanations. Brian Rothschild, the founding dean of University of Massachusetts Dartmouth School for Marine Science and Technology, noted that in the 1990s, the growth rate of individual cod had declined, fish were skinnier than before, and the mortality rate had quadrupled. The weight-to-length ratio went down, so that instead of looking like a fish, a cod looked more like a snake, he said in a talk at the New Bedford Fishing Heritage Center in 2012. Natural mortality increased substantially during the population decline. The population of species associated with cod also declined, so the crash was not obviously related to fishing, as declines in growth, length weight, and increases in natural mortality are unrelated to fishing. Clearly, something else was affecting the fish, perhaps nutrition due to the lower levels of capelin, herring, and mackerel, food sources that have been scooped up by trawlers with small mesh nets, which also collect juvenile cod. Perhaps the out-of-control gray seal population, which feast on cod, has had an effect. And, of course, warming ocean water likely reduced reproduction and drove cod to colder waters. On top of overfishing, the Gulf of Maine is warming faster than 99% of the world's oceans, which is clearly stressing and changing the whole marine ecosystem. The warm Gulf Stream is extending farther up the Atlantic coast, and the cold, nutrient-rich Labrador Current from the Arctic is warming as glaciers melt. The admixture of these two supercurrents creates the upwelling of nutrients to feed the phytoplankton, minuscule algae that wander near the surface of the ocean but sit at the bottom of the marine food web. It just happens that cod were one of the main pieces of the Gulf of Maine and Georges Bank ecosystems, which have been changing as currents shift and the water warms, discussed in Chapter 2. In really warm years, every female cod produces fewer babies than we would expect, and we also see that the young fish are less likely to survive and become adults. Andrew Pershing, at the time an oceanographer at the Gulf of Maine Research Institute, noted in Science magazine in 2015. It was the first paper to explicitly link ocean warming to the cod decline. In 1994, the United States followed Canada's suit and closed three major areas of Georges Bank, a 6,600-square-mile area on the rich continental shelf, shallow submarine plateau, that has long been one of the world's hallowed fishing grounds. cod migrate back and forth between the United States and Canada across the Hague Line that marks sovereign waters on the eastern edge of Georgia's Bank. To a much lesser degree, cod also migrate between Georgia's Bank and the Gulf of Maine, and NOAA, a division of the Commerce Department that runs NOAA Fisheries, also called the National Marine Fisheries Service, considers them different stocks in its assessments. Besides Atlantic cod stocks in the United States and Canada, other stocks are found in Iceland, the North Sea, Celtic Sea, and White Sea, part of the Barents Sea. An Arcto-Norwegian stock is in another part of the Barents Sea. The New England Fisheries Management Council, one of eight regional councils in the United States that manages fisheries, recommended the closure after scientists determined that the fishery could be saved only if fishing in certain areas was reduced to zero. The 1993 catch of cod, haddock, and flounder was down 23% from the previous year, which itself had been a down year. Other changes in management included days at sea restrictions, an increase in net mesh sizes to let juveniles escape, and a vessel buyback program to reduce the size of the fleet after the government inadvertently expanded it with subsidized loans in the 1970s and 1980s. In addition to cod, fishing for scallops and yellowtail flounder was also scaled way back. The flounder stock was dangerously depleted, and the bulk of scallops were dangerously small, many below harvestable size. Fishermen didn't like this, even though fishermen sit on the council. One scientist says one thing, and another scientist says something else, Gloucester fisherman Jay Sperling told the Christian Science Monitor. They're not even out on the water. They don't see the things we see. So few people eat fish, and the ocean is so big, I think they're making a huge mistake. The decision set in motion a seemingly never-ending battle that engaged at various times regulators, fishermen, environmentalists, politicians, and the courts, a battle of rolling lawsuits that began in 1992 and ran through 2005. In 2000, five environmental groups brought suit against NOAA Fisheries for not doing enough to prevent overfishing. In 2001, U.S. District Court Judge Gladys Kessler ruled against NOAA Fisheries and ordered it to come up with a solution. In 2002, Judge Kessler imposed the most restrictive fishing limits ever on New England fishermen, closing more areas to fishing and cutting the days at sea limit from 88 to 70. The judge later abandoned the order, saying it would cause too much economic pain, and deferred to a new plan agreed to by environmentalists and fishermen. In 2002, during this legal wrangling, fishermen discovered that the RV, research vessel, Albatross 4, R-342, a scientific survey vessel, had incorrectly set its trawl net and generally mismanaged the tow. NOAA's Northeast Fisheries Science Center admitted that over the previous 2 years, the survey trawl net had been incorrectly set, according to the Fishing Heritage Center in New Bedford. Needless to say, such revelations infuriated fishermen who had for years suspected invalid stock assessments. Adding fuel to the fire, NOAA Fisheries claimed the faulty surveys had no impact on stock assessments. Fishermen and local media dubbed this fiasco Trawlgate. In 2004, NOAA Fisheries began a 10-year rebuilding plan for Gulf of Maine cod. The plan held until NOAA Fisheries declared in 2008 that the stock was healthy and headed toward recovery. Stock projected to rebuild rapidly, stated the report. But that didn't happen, as in 2011, another study suggested the stock was in dismal shape and would not rebuild by 2014. Apparently, the 2008 report, which cited data from heavy cod spawning in 2005, overstated the number of spawning fish by 300%. As always, the fishermen were seeing something different on the water. Gloucester fisherman Vito Giacalone saw it as another instance of fishery science conflicting with all the other indicators of common sense. He said fishermen were catching more cod in less time, in more areas, and with a wider range of age and size. In 2010, NOAA Fisheries switched from a days-at-sea regulatory regime to a catch-quota regime, which limited the volume of fish any boat could take in a year. That was another dagger in the hearts of fishermen. Hunters had seen grounds close and open and close and were being told when, where, and how much to hunt. Later, in 2015, they were told to take government observers on board and pay for them. In 2020, NOAA Fisheries had 891 observers, all professionally trained biological scientists. In 2014, the United States announced that the Gulf of Maine cod rebuild would be extended to 2024, and the rebuild of Georgia's bank cod would be extended until 2027. John Bullard, then the administrator of NOAA Fisheries Greater Atlantic Region, appearing at a hearing of the New England Fisheries Management Council in 2014, was harangued by fishermen about the surveys that had led to various restrictions. One said, "You lie for a living." Bullard responded, "You owe me an apology. I'm probably not going to get one, but I deserve one." Later he said, "Hunters go where the fish are, and scientists have sampling protocols. They look for consistent patterns and grids across a large region rather than single sightings. That's a recipe for distrust between scientists and fishermen." In 2014, government scientists saw cod reduced to 1% of its 1980s biomass, while fishermen saw big aggregations, notably right outside Gloucester Harbor. Fishermen had said the same thing in 1994 when Georgia's Bank was shut down. Raymond Mayo, a marine biologist for NOAA Fisheries at Woods Hole at the time, called this a perception problem. "You see some cod and assume this is the tip of the iceberg," he told Mark Kurlansky, author of Cod, a biography of fish that changed the world. "But it could be the whole iceberg. The cod were aggregating, which is what they do when there aren't many of them left," said Bullard after the 2014 announcement. "They may have been visible in pockets, especially in the western Gulf of Maine, one of cod's main spawning grounds, but they were otherwise scarce. This observation conforms to the alley effect, first described in the 1930s by its namesake, Warder Clyde Alley, who suggested that aggregation can improve the survival rate of individuals and that cooperation may be crucial in the overall evolution of social structure. At the time, the traditional theory of population dynamics was that a species will grow more slowly at a higher density and faster at a lower density. But Ali demonstrated that the reverse holds true when a population density is low and under duress. Individuals, he said, often require the assistance of others for more than simple reproductive reasons in order to persist, just as animals hunt or defend against predators as a group. This would not have been news to Charles Darwin, who had written in On the Origin of Species that a large stock of individuals of the same species relative to the number of its enemies is absolutely necessary for its preservation. American landings of Atlantic cod were worth $118 million in 1991. By 2014, when the cod father was passing off cod as haddock 2 years before his arrest, cod landings were worth a mere $9 million, what NOAA Fisheries Bullard called the biggest collapse of a fish species in such a short time frame in more than 100 years. Rusty red scallops, once hunted, now harvested. The groundfish industry has contracted significantly on the East Coast, as everybody knows, and what's left of it is concentrated in New Bedford, but its overall share of the landings in the port are quite small. New Bedford Mayor John Mitchell said in 2017, "Less than 10% of the value of the annual landings of the port of New Bedford come from groundfish these days." That is the hard truth. The iconic cod had really become a small part of the food value chain in the greater Atlantic region, ranging from Cape Hatteras to the maritime boundary with Canada. The real money is in lobster and scallops, worth an estimated $668 million and $572 million, respectively, in 2019. Nationally, the top value fishery is wild Pacific salmon, followed by lobster, crab of various types, and Atlantic scallops. The top volume fish in the United States is typically Alaskan pollock, which is often the top catch in the world, annually vying for that honor with Peruvian anchoveta. The future of groundfish on the East Coast may be in hitherto underutilized species such as skate, monkfish, redfish, dogfish, and Atlantic pollock, along with haddock, a boom and bust species, now booming. For the moment, scallops have replaced groundfish, yellowtail flounder even more so than cod in the New Bedford value chain, and made it the most valuable fishing port in the United States for the past 20 years. In 2019, the port of New Bedford recorded $451 million in landings, more than 80% from scallops. The price of scallops has more than doubled since 2002, now ranging from $10 to $15 a pound at auction, depending on size. At one point in 2021, the price hit $30 a pound, wholesale. At the daily buyers and sellers exchange, base auction in New Bedford, 150,000 pounds or more of scallops are electronically bought by bid in less than an hour. It is hard to imagine that 22 years ago, several scallop grounds were closed to fishing. The story of scallop success is in many ways the inverse of the cod story. New Bedford scallopers are hunters turned harvesters. They are now essentially wealthy ranchers, wealthier than any New Bedford fishermen since the whalers in the 19th century, rotating and harvesting scallop beds as if they were rotating crops on farmland. The tactics changed around 2000 after the terrible downturn of the 1990s. After a peak catch of 37 million pounds in 1991, scallop landings along the East Coast plummeted to less than 10 million pounds in 1994. In 1993, federal agents wearing bulletproof vests, they had been threatened by fishermen in the past, raided 22 scalloping boats and seized $126,220 worth of scallops. Six boat owners were charged with catching undersized scallops. Meanwhile, other boat owners were smuggling cocaine and pot into New Bedford, which has been home to sin and sinners since the 1660s and the Puritan Age. Rum was unloaded here in the 1660s and sent by small boats and wagons to buyers from Maine to Rhode Island, writes Rory Nugent in Down at the Docks. The harbor was condemned from the pulpit by the Puritan's chief guide on the path to salvation, Reverend Increase Mather. Later, his son Cotton burnished the setting by denouncing the waterfront as Lucifer's kingdom. Two centuries later, whaling ships brought chests of opium home from India, Arabia, and China, making New Bedford the nation's top import center for opium and hashish, says Nugent. During Prohibition, seaplanes working for Joe Kennedy, the patriarch of the Kennedy political clan, would unload illicit alcohol from boats in the middle of Buzzard's Bay in the dark of night and fly it back to distribution points in New Bedford, where an intricate system of tunnels connected the waterfront to sites in the business district, such as the old Cultivator Shoals Bar, now the Rose Alley Ale House on the waterfront. Kennedy's office in a small cove in New Bedford Harbor was affectionately called Big Joe's Mudflats. In the 1960s, the drug of choice was pot. In the 1970s, coke and heroin were in demand. In the 1960s and 1970s, the mafia treated New Bedford like a cash machine for junk, dope, gambling, and prostitution. In the 1980s, bust after bust uncovered tens of millions of dollars worth of marijuana on fishing boats. Illicit trade and criminal behavior are clearly nothing new in New Bedford and have a storied past. But in the 1990s, the smuggling was largely born of a desperation to put boats to work rather than a desire to make a quick, illicit, tax-free buck. The industry was on the brink, and it was going to get worse. At a 1994 New England Fisheries Management Council meeting to determine how to protect yellowtail flounder, Bullard from NOAA Fisheries recounted a scalloper blurting out that there were plenty of flounder around. "When I go scalloping, I can catch 30,000 pounds of yellowtail." That same year, a judge presiding over a lawsuit brought by the Conservation Law Foundation said that if the council wouldn't protect groundfish, the court would manage the fishery, says Mike Sissenwine, who was the senior scientist of NOAA Fisheries at the time and later the science and research director for the Northeast Fisheries Science Center. Council members moved to close off several portions of Georges Bank and the Nantucket Shoals to fishing for cod, flounder, and scallops. Scalloping was basically an open-access industry through the 1980s, said Ronald Smolowitz, a marine scientist and a founder of the Coonamesset Farm Foundation, which conducts scallop research. There was very little science telling you which way things were going, and very little enforcement to make sure the management measures were working. By 1994, we had hit a low point. There was no place to go but up. In 1995, 1 year after the closures, researchers piloting remotely operated vehicles saw something unexpected. The muddy bottom was littered with market-sized scallops, rusty red and round as saucers. By 1996 and 1997, NOAA Fisheries knew the scallops had come back, but the New England Fishery Management Council hadn't reopened the closed grounds because there was no plan to protect the yellowtail flounder. The fishermen also knew scallops were abundant in the closed areas because they had likely been fishing there illegally, says Sissenwine. That may be true, but the scallopers were suffering economically. The opportunistic cod father, who always had jingles to spare, had even swooped in to buy 3 scallop dredges for pennies on the dollar in 1995. A third of the vessel owners were facing bankruptcy and desperate to return to their hallowed hunting grounds. To further reduce landings, the New England Fisheries Management Council cut the allowable days at sea and the number of crew on a vessel. With areas on Georges Bank and the Nantucket Shoals closed, pressure built on the remaining open areas, especially in the mid-Atlantic. "We were looking at 51 days at sea in 2000, said Bobby Bruno, owner of a New Bedford scalloper. "That was not enough to survive. We had to do something. We came together to show that there were adequate scallops out there." A small group of scallop boat owners formed the Fisheries Survival Fund. A founder of the fund, Marjorie J. Orman, owner of a Fairhaven, Massachusetts settlement house, later testified in court that the proposed restrictions on fishing were so severe that they threatened to reduce scallop fishing to levels at which the vessels could not cover their costs and economically survive. The Fishery Survival Fund solicited help from Brian Rothschild, who was then dean of UMass Dartmouth's new graduate school for marine science and technology. Rothschild remembers standing in the Fairhaven shipyard on a snowy day when a group of scallop fishermen came up to him. They said, "Brian, what can you do for us? We're going broke." Rothschild began advocating for an experimental permit to allow limited fishing for research purposes in the closed areas. After some misfires with the application, Sissenwine and Rothschild co-convened a session at Woods Hole to organize a series of dredge surveys of the closed areas on Georges Bank using commercial scallopers. Steve Morawski, a NOAA fisheries scientist working out of Woods Hole Laboratory at the time and now at the University of South Florida's College of Marine Science, led the scientific effort and worked with the scallop industry on survey logistics, which included both sampling randomly selected locations and depletion tows over the same area to estimate the efficiency of a scallop dredge. Paul Rago, a biologist at the NOAA Fisheries Northeast Science Center, had successfully deployed the technique the year before for a survey of surf clams. "You do one dredge after another, and the number of scallops you see on dredge number 6 or 7 gives you an idea of the stock's abundance," says Rothschild. Multiple dredges of the same territory compensate for the fact that one dredge only tells you what it caught, not what else is down there. One tow shows the relative mass compared to other areas, but not the total abundance. On the randomized tows, we were also getting good data on the catch rate of yellowtail flounder by location, says Sissenwine. Those data eventually helped set quotas on yellowtail bycatch when the closed beds were opened, the first time bycatch quotas had been used in New England. Tracking catches in real time definitely helped cut down the accidental capture of yellowtail flounder. By 2016, scallopers were catching only 5% as many flounder as they had landed in the 1990s. The two-week dredge survey in late summer of 1998 used New Bedford scallopers chosen by lottery, including Malvin Quillhog, Bobby Bruno, Herman Bruce, and Marty Manley. The captains, who were from the Fisheries Survival Fund, donated fuel, food, and vessels. In exchange for their time, the captains were allowed to keep 10,000 to 14,000 pounds of scallops to cover costs and pay for observers to assure that data were accurate and complete. The project went well until analysis of the data began and disagreements arose about the efficiency of the dredges, which affected the estimates of abundance. In short, the regulators and fishermen ended up with different math. Different players perceived their roles differently and had different motivations for how they wanted to release the data. Different estimates of scallop biomass were coming out that may have created false expectations, says NOAA Fisheries Murawski. Forging ahead with his interpretation of the data, Rothschild implored Senator Edward Kennedy, a Democrat from Massachusetts, to get involved. He called a summit in New Bedford and invited William Daley, then the Secretary of Commerce, who oversees NOAA Fisheries, to attend. Representative Barney Frank, a Democrat from Massachusetts, a big supporter of fisheries, was also involved. Back in D.C. after the summit, Daley, who had veto power over the New England Fishery Management Council, pushed to open the closed areas to scalloping, overriding concerns of environmentalists and the New England Fisheries Management Council, according to the Boston Globe. In June 1998, part of a closed Area 2 on Georgia's Bank was open to scalloping, with restrictions on both scallops and yellowtail flounder. For its role in reopening the beds without adhering to the mandates of the 1996 Sustainable Fisheries Act, the Commerce Department was later sued by the Conservation Law Foundation, along with the Center for Marine Conservation, National Audubon Society, and National Resources Defense Council. This was part of the aforementioned series of lawsuits brought by a variety of environmental NGO plaintiffs. Writing an op-ed in the Standard Times in 2010, Congressman Frank reflected on Daley's pivotal role. He based his decision on data presented by the seafood industry in New Bedford, which turned out to have been accurate, and we benefited from an increase in scallop quotas without any negative effect on the stocks. By 2001, NOAA Fisheries proclaimed the fishery rebuilt. In fact, NOAA Fisheries scientists in Woods Hole had predicted that the stock would quickly rebuild to levels never before seen as a result of protecting small scallops. With that first 1998 survey on the books, the focus shifted to two other areas that had been closed since 1994, Closed Area 1 and Nantucket Lightship, Shoals. In regular surveys, vessel samples throughout the sea scallops range, looking at relative abundance and stock conditions, collecting data at hundreds of stations from the Mid-Atlantic through Georgia's Bank. The August 1999 survey with commercial vessels was more intensive, occupying some 500 sites in and around just these two areas. What resulted from this collection of intensive spatial data was a graphic description of critical habitat and an array of policy options set out in much more detail with what fishermen perceived as more reliable information, said Murawski. The School for Marine Science and Technology and New Bedford Boats were not part of the 1999 surveys. The Virginia Institute of Marine Science played the academic role. Meanwhile, the New Bedford group was already heading in a different direction. Kevin Stokesbury, a research associate at the School for Marine Science and Technology, who had joined the NOAA Fisheries Survey Project in September 1998 to do data entry and analysis, began to promote the idea of a video analysis as a more efficient, immediate, and less intrusive way to survey than dredging. After the debate over the efficiency of different dredges, Stokesbury didn't think doing more depletion tows would contribute further knowledge, according to a 2000 report by the National Fisheries Conservation Center. I told Brian I had surveyed scallops in shallow water by scuba diving and thought it could be done in deeper water with video, said Stokesbury. Brian said, prove it. Besides sidestepping the controversy over the efficiency of tows, a video survey didn't require an experimental permit for fishing. With some preliminary drawings, with help from Gil Fain, an engineering student, Stokesbury and scallopers used PVC pipe to build a pyramid that could hold lights and a camera and roll along the sea bottom. After testing it in shallow water, they took the design to welders. Kevin had the ideas. Fishermen know how to modify gear, said scalloper Bruno. The result was a 700-pound steel pyramid rigged with lights and cameras, with cable feeds back to computer screens and video recorders in the wheelhouse. Dropping the steel pyramid off the stern winch of a commercial scalloper, Danny Eilertson on the Liberty, Chris Wright on the Huntress, and Gabe Miranda on the Friendship, the first small-scale scallop surveys showed those same rusty red market-sized scallops that the autonomous robot had seen in 1995. The drop camera system Brian and I developed using video worked like a charm, says Stokesbury. It's hard to argue with a picture of scallops on the seafloor. In a 2002 paper on the surveys, Stokesbury wrote that the density of the scallops was the highest and their size was the largest ever seen on George's Bank. Sissonwine said that results from the dredge survey and video survey were very consistent. Researchers completed the surveys in August and provided estimates of abundance to the scallop plan development team in September. The New England Fishery Management Council used both video and dredge data to devise management measures that allowed limited opening of Closed Area 1 and Nantucket Lightship in 2000. Murawski later described the story of the scallop fisheries rebound as a great collaboration between the scientific, regulatory, and academic communities.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.